Amen. May the Lord indeed do so. And even this morning, as I invite you to take out your copy of God's Word and turn with me in the New Testament to Hebrews chapter 10. That'll be the text for our lesson this morning. Hebrews chapter 10, we'll be reading verses 1 through 18, but we will have particular reference to verses 10, 14, and 18 this morning. The entire context will be important, so we'll read verses 1 through 18, but then focus our attention on those three verses of our text in particular. I would invite you to stand as we prepare to read God's Word, that we might hear it with reverence, that we might hear it as people who are eager not only to hear the Word of the Lord, but to believe it and indeed to obey it. Let's bow now and ask God's blessing to that end. Gracious God and Father, give us ears to hear this morning, O Lord, that we might not be merely hearers of the Word, but indeed doers of it. Bless your Word to your people this morning. Bless the mouth of your servant, that though through a fallible instrument, O God, your infallible Spirit might be our teacher to edify, sanctify, and strengthen us this day. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hear now the Word of God, that which is holy, righteous, and will stand forever. Hebrews chapter 10, beginning at verse 1. For the law, having a shadow of the good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with these same sacrifices, which they offer continually year by year, make those who approach perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered. For the worshipers, once purified, would have had no more consciousness of sins. But in those sacrifices there is a reminder of sins every year, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away sins. Therefore, when he came into the world, he said, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin you had no pleasure. Then I said, 'Behold, I have come. In the volume of the book it is written of me, to do your will, O God.'" Previously saying, "Sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings and offerings for sin you did not desire, nor had pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law." Then he said, "Behold, I have come to do your will, O God." He takes away the first, that he may establish the second. By that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God, from that time waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us, for after he had said before, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds I will write them." Then he adds, "Their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more." Now where there is remission of these, there is no longer an offering for sin. The grass withers, the flower fades, God's word stands forever. This is God's word. May he add his blessing to it. You may be seated. What did Jesus die in order to do? That is the question that we are looking at this morning. What is actually accomplished by the sacrifice of Christ? Now, this is the third week in a short series on the grace of God, and we've looked already at the necessity of God's grace in salvation and at the potency of that grace in salvation. Today, we're looking at the specificity of that grace in salvation. And that may seem to be a heading that is a bit odd. This may be strange to you that we would think about grace as if it were a specific thing. But in fact, it is a specific power, a specific work that God performs upon a specific people. Now, when we ask, what did Jesus die to do? What did his death actually accomplish? You might think that the answer to those questions is fairly obvious. And in one sense, the answer is very obvious. If we're content with simply following what Scripture says, if we're content to answer Bible questions in Bible ways, well, then this one is not difficult to answer. But do you know that historically, Christians and theologians have answered this question in a number of different ways? What was accomplished by the sacrifice of Christ? It depends on who you ask. It depends upon what Christian tradition, so-called, you are part of. It depends on what school of thought you might follow. And those different answers say more about our theological commitments than about Scripture's clarity. In fact, the Bible is very clear. Of course, all of us agree that it's very clear. We just don't agree on what it clearly says. And the reason that we don't agree is because of our presuppositions. We have these various biases. We have often read Scripture uncritically, having not examined thoroughly the preconceptions that we brought with us to that reading. Most Christians will affirm that Jesus died in order to save sinners. I say most Christians because there are some who would profess to be Christians, who would identify themselves in that way, who would say that his death was for another purpose. But the overwhelming majority of those who identify as Christians would affirm that, yes, Jesus died to save sinners. The Bible says so very clearly. But the question today is, did he actually accomplish that goal? Now, we could say, yes, he did in one sense, because we know from Scripture itself that some sinners have already been saved. And we expect and hope that some sinners today are also saved and that more will be before the Lord returns. But the question is really, was that outcome certain? Not has anyone been saved by the work of Christ, but would anyone certainly be saved by the work of Christ? Did Jesus actually accomplish and secure the salvation of anyone? Or did his death and resurrection only make salvation possible for everyone? You understand the contrast? You understand the question? That's the question we're wrestling with this morning. Again, did Jesus actually accomplish and secure the salvation of anyone? Or did his work on the cross and in his resurrection only make salvation possible for everyone? Well, the way that we are going to approach this is by appealing to Hebrews chapter 10. And in Hebrews chapter 10, as we read the first 18 verses, we see an extended discussion, all of which is relevant, actually, for our study this morning. We see the way in which the work of Christ, the priestly work of Christ, both the priest offering the sacrifice and the lamb who is offered in this priestly work of atonement, Jesus accomplishes what the Old Testament system of sacrifices never could. That's the contrast here. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin. And yet, very clearly, in Leviticus chapter 4, in Leviticus chapter 11, and in many subsequent historical and prophetical texts in the Hebrew Bible, that is exactly what animal sacrifice is said to accomplish. The Lord says, I have given you the blood of these animals on the altar to make atonement for your soul, and when you offer them in this way, your sins will be forgiven. That's His promise at the end of the regulations concerning the sin offering Leviticus chapter 4. That's God's promise. And yet now the Hebrews writer is saying, that can't happen. That can't be. The blood of bulls and goats cannot accomplish that kind of salvation. Well, how then can God bestow it? And the Hebrew writer's answer is Christ. Christ is the way in which those former administrations were effectual. In fact, in the previous chapter that we did not read today, Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 15, the Hebrews writer says that Christ provided redemption for the transgressions under the first covenant. In other words, Jesus' blood flows forward and backward in time, we might say. His righteousness covers all. His righteousness makes good the promises and payments of redemption that God made in the Old Testament, sins that were passed over, Paul would say in Romans chapter 3, no adequate atonement having been made, He will nevertheless forgive Noah and Abraham and Moses and David and Elijah and Jeremiah. He will forgive these men in view of that which is to come. And that is the work of Christ. But the Hebrew writer says that now Christ has come and He's accomplished in His ministry something that never could be accomplished by anything that had gone before. Now, why is this idea that Christ's work is very specific, not general, not just an offer, not just an invitation, not just an opportunity for the mass of humanity? Why is this idea that grace is a special and specific work to a special and specific people, why is that so controversial? I think there are a few reasons for that. One is that people generally have an assumption of God's universal love. In fact, even people sometimes who are not in any meaningful way religious, they will assume that God loves everyone equally and in the same way. Certainly, many professed Christians have this as a governing assumption of their theology. As I go around the community and teach classes during the week, I encounter this very often by Christians who actually know very little about the Bible. And I don't say that to be pejorative or to be critical, but these are people who have not read much of Scripture at all, who have not carefully studied, and yet have this absolute certainty that surely the Bible must somewhere teach this idea. But if they look carefully at the text, they might be surprised that some of the texts even that they think would support such a thesis, like John chapter 3 and verse 16, might in fact be seen to undermine that very conclusion. There are a few passages that I want to suggest to you this morning just in challenging this idea of the assumption of God's universal love. For instance, out of the Psalter, Psalm 5, verses 4 to 6. For you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness, nor shall evil dwell with you. The boastful shall not stand in your sight. You hate all workers of iniquity. You shall destroy those who speak falsehood. Yahweh abhors the bloodthirsty and deceitful man. So much for him hating the sin but loving the sinner. Of course, God does love sinners. The Bible says that very clearly. But which sinners is the Bible referring to? It's not just all sinners in general. It's not as though God is sitting up in heaven in this grandfatherly way, wringing his hands over the disobedience of so many human beings and saying, I just love you all so much. I just wish that you would behave yourselves. No, the Bible actually says that God hates workers of iniquity. He abhors bloodthirsty and deceitful people. In Psalm 7, in verse 11, God is a just judge and God is angry with the wicked every day. Anger is not always wrong. Our anger usually is, frequently is. It's contaminated by our sinful nature. God's anger is always righteous. And God is angry with the wicked every day. What do you think Jesus is saving us from? He's not saving us from the devil. He's saving us from the Father. He's saving us from the holy wrath of a righteous God. Psalm 11 and verse 5, Yahweh tests the righteous, but the wicked and the one who loves violence, his soul hates. Or the book of Proverbs, chapter 6, verses 16 through 19, there are six things Yahweh hates. Yes, seven that are an abomination to him. A proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift in running to evil. Up until this point, you may be thinking to yourself, yes, but all of those are hatred of sinful dispositions. Well, keep reading. A false witness who speaks lies and one who sows discord among his brethren. God hates a divisive person. Did you know that? He abhors it. This is not God in this passive, pleading, sort of pathetic way, looking at disobedient children and just saying, I just love those little brats so much. They just won't ever behave. They won't ever cooperate. No. God takes a very studied attitude against. He sets himself in opposition to those who are in opposition to him. Does God love everyone equally and in the same way? Clearly not. Now, does that mean then that he loves those who deserve his love or those among the human race who are lovable? No, because clearly the Bible says there's nobody in that category. There's nobody that deserves the love of God. God's love is entirely gratuitous. This is why this point is important, brothers and sisters. It's not to convince you that God is an angry, grumpy God who just hates everyone. That's not the point. The point is for you to realize how amazing God's love actually is. If God loves everyone equally and in the same way, then it's not a surprise that God loves you. Of all people, he loves you. Of course he loves you because he loves everyone. No. No. God hates and abhors evil and evildoers. And yet he loves you. But did you know that you were once evil? And that you are still often evil? Acting like an evil doer. Oh, you may have been forgiven of your sins, but you're still a sinner, and so am I. God has not set his love upon us because we are lovable, because we are worthy, because we cleaned up our act in some way. And this is what is marvelous and mystifying about the love of God. Why would God, who hates and abhors sinners, love any sinner? And yet he does. He has, and he forever will in his Son. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and yet the Bible very clearly affirms that God loves sinners and justifies the ungodly. How can he do that? Well, the answer in part is that we think of the love of God or the hatred of God in the same way that we think of our own love and hatred. We think of it as an emotion, an attitude. But in fact, God doesn't have emotions in the way that we do. There's emotional language in Scripture that helps us kind of analogically understand these ideas, but God is not like us. We are made in certain respects like Him. He is not in any respect like us. And when we think about the love of God and the anger of God, we think of love and anger that is changeable. He loves me, He loves me not. I fall into love and I fall out of love. I feel happy today and then something happens and now I'm angry. This is not the way that God is. His love is a continuous, a constant, a perfect expression of favor. His anger, His wrath is a continuous, constant, perfect expression of His righteousness in contradistinction to sin. Not every person is loved by God in this way. Now we could say that God is kind to all people. He is. Because the most wicked person in the world at this present moment is not yet in hell. The most God-defying, blaspheming, violent person in the world is not in hell. And you can only attribute that to the kindness of God. Yes, God causes the sun to rise on the good and on the evil. He sends rain on the just and on the unjust. It wasn't just faithful churches that got rain this morning. But do not flatten out the love of God as if these general expressions of kindness and forbearance are the love of God to which Scripture attributes our salvation. Remember the passage we looked at 2 weeks ago in Ephesians chapter 2? We are dead in our sins, but God, who is rich in mercy because of His great love with which He loved us. And yet if you say the love of God is given equally, without distinction, to all people in all places and at all times, there is nothing great about that love. And now you have a real problem because you have to explain why God, in His great love, has not saved everyone. Because the Bible says that salvation is the result of His love. No, that salvation is the result of His love, and that love is set upon those whom He is pleased to save. Not every person, but those whom He chose before the foundation of the world, Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4, whose names He wrote in the book of life at that time, not later when they believed, Revelation 13 and 17, those whom He gave to His Son to redeem in John 6, 8, 10, 17, and many other places. Is it hard to understand that God has a special love of favor toward His children? I don't think it is hard. We've used this analogy many times. I love all of the children in this church, every one of them. I think we have just the best kids of any church I've ever been a part of. All of our kids are amazing. Many of them are cute. I love them, I pray for them constantly. But there are five of them that I love in a special and unique way. There are five of them that I love differently. And you love yours differently than you love mine. And that's not wrong. In fact, it would be wrong for it to be otherwise, brothers and sisters. It is not hard for us to understand that God would show special favor to His family. And the Bible does not describe the human race as the family of God. It describes those who are elect in Christ, washed in His blood, sanctified by the Spirit, pardoned, adopted. That is the family of God. And there is a special love and favor that He has toward them. I think another reason that this topic is controversial is because, along with this assumption of universal love from God, people assume that there is this universal grace as well. They assume that God extends His grace to every person without any distinction at all. And this assumption, by the way, more so than the first, seems at least at the beginning to have some biblical basis. For instance, in Titus chapter 2 and verse 11, the Apostle Paul says, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men." There you go. Grace has appeared to all men. Or in 1 Timothy chapter 2, "For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved." There you go. God desires everyone to be saved. He's extending His grace, therefore, to all people. Or 2 Peter chapter 3, "The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." Of course, those interpretations of those particular texts, which seem to prove that God shows grace and extends mercy to all people universally in the same way, actually prove too much. Because if God is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, then His will be thwarted and defeated. Because the Bible is equally clear that not all people will come to repentance, that there will be reprobates who are cast into hell. And so if you make that passage say that God doesn't want anyone to be lost, He wants every single person in the history of the world to be saved, then you have to conclude God is not going to get what He wants. The all-powerful, all-knowing, ever-present, transcendent creator of heaven and earth, sovereign Lord of the universe and of all history is going to fail in His program of salvation. Of course, there are other ways of reading those passages if you don't like the implications of reading them that way. And there are several things that need to be said, and those passages need to be dealt with on their own in a more detailed way, but at least three things that I would suggest for you to consider this morning. First, there is a clear difference in Scripture between the invitation of the gospel and the application of saving grace. This is a point that is often overlooked. People will take a text that speaks of the invitation of the gospel, which is universal, which is undifferentiated, which is to all nations, to all people, in all places and at all times, and they will infer from that invitation that grace is applied in a coextensive fashion. But that is clearly not the case. All people are called to trust in Jesus. All people are called to bow the knee. Not all people will. And those who do not clearly have not received the grace of God that brings that faith and repentance. Secondly, the word all is used in different ways, and context has to determine what it means in any particular place. And that's not just a Bible principle, brothers and sisters. That's a language principle. That's true in every language that I've ever studied. It's certainly true in English. Your Bible in Luke chapter 2 says that all the world was to be registered according to the Roman order. Does that mean every single individual person in every part of the globe? Or does it mean all of the families in the Roman world? I don't think that's hard to figure out. Your Bible also says in Mark chapter 1 that all Judea and those from Jerusalem were baptized by John. Does that mean every single person in Judea and Jerusalem? It seems to, until you continue reading the Gospel of Mark and find out that a whole bunch of people in Jerusalem and Judea never were baptized by John, and they are hostile to him and to Jesus. What does the Bible mean when it says in Hebrews chapter 8, quoting from Jeremiah chapter 31, that in the new covenant all will know the Lord? Does it mean that every person in the world or every person in a subset of the world will know the Lord, in this case, those who belong to the new covenant? There's a difference between all without distinction and all without exception. All are commanded to come, and God is drawing all kinds of different people, but not every single person will come. And you have to think about that as you read passages like this. And that's the third point that is to be made. All of who? God desires all to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. All of whom? Who is God saving? The Bible is very clear that to whatever extent a universal invitation is given, the intent and application of saving grace is very specific. It is given to those whom God is drawing to Himself, sanctifying by His Son, indwelling by His Spirit, and that we will see even more clearly today. There's one other reason that this is controversial, though, that I need to mention before we proceed, and that is the failure to make careful definitions and distinctions. Turretin is our help here. He constantly is talking about in his Institutes of Eclectic Theology that we make distinctions. Distinctions is an important part of Orthodox theology. Many times people begin throwing around words like the love of God and the grace of God without ever defining what they mean by those terms. Is grace simply an opportunity? Is it a general provision without actualized potency? Or is it an effectual sacrifice applied by God to specific individuals who are brought to life and faith by that grace? If you say it's God's will for all men to be saved, what do you mean exactly by that? Because it depends on which will you're talking about. Are we talking about God's revealed will? His word of command that goes out to all nations? Well, then you could say, yes, God calls all men to repent and believe. Or are we talking about His secret will? what he decreed would happen before the foundation of the world. We could go on and on talking about why the failure to make proper definitions and distinctions leads us into error in these passages. But let me, for the sake of our study this morning, tell you how I'm using important terms today. Grace is God's gift, and it is his power for saving sinners. It is not merely a potential, but an actual work which accomplishes what God intends by means of Christ's sacrifice. When I say grace, I do not mean general benevolence. I do not mean merely an opportunity. I mean a power that performs what God intends to do without the recipient's agency. Grace precedes our participation. It precedes and enables our cooperation. We're not denying that believers cooperate with that grace, but it's at a later stage of the game. And they can only cooperate because of that grace. Grace is the power that brings about the new birth without which no man is able to believe. It is the gift which enables faith and repentance and which fills the human heart with love for God who loved that sinner first. Grace is an enabling bestowal, not an offer that you can accept or not. It's a transforming influence, not an opportunity to change yourself. In other words, grace does not make salvation possible. It actually saves God's people. Now, that's how I'm using the term this morning. You could disagree with that definition and those distinctions, but you're going to need to do so by appealing to Scripture. And now it's my obligation to show you from this scripture today, one out of hundreds, why I think this type of distinction and definition is appropriate. All right, let's look at our text. Verse 10 that we read through just a moment ago, look at it with me again. By that will, and here the Hebrew writer is talking about the will of God that Jesus comes to do. So he's talking about all of the sacrifices of the Old Testament system, the Mosaic economy, the administration of the covenant of grace, which includes priests in the tabernacle and temple and animals offered on an altar, none of which is ultimately able to accomplish the end that God has promised. And yet now Jesus comes into the world and he says, "Behold, I have come to do your will." In other words, this is what you will to do. You will to save sinners. And the Levites can't do it. And bulls and goats can't do it. And the Old Testament economy cannot do it. But Jesus has come to do it. He has come to do what God willed to be done. Notice verse 10. By that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Sanctification can be used a few different ways in the New Testament. In some respects, the Hebrews writer uses both sanctification and glorification in this letter in a way that is almost synonymous with the way that Paul uses justification in Romans and Galatians. We'll talk about that more in a minute. But generally speaking, sanctification refers to holiness. And when we talk about sanctification and salvation, we're talking about that process whereby God grows us in holiness and Christ-likeness. That's most often what we have in mind. But not here. Did you notice the difference here? We normally are talking about what theologians would describe as progressive sanctification. But that's not what the Hebrews writer refers to here. By that will, we have been sanctified once for all through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ. He's describing a sanctification that is already accomplished, something that is complete. It is a definitive act. And in this act, a person is set apart from the world and placed in covenant with God. It's exactly what Paul is describing in Colossians chapter 1 when he says we have been transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the beloved Son. It's exactly what he describes in Ephesians chapter 2 when he says we have been raised out of death and sin, raised with Christ, and seated with Christ in heavenly places. We've been moved. You no longer belong here in this kingdom. You belong there in God's kingdom. God is setting you apart, and he's done it once and forever. The Hebrews writer does not say, by that will we can be sanctified if we believe and endure. He does not say that Christ's sacrifice makes this sanctification possible. He says that by God's will, which Christ has fulfilled, we have been sanctified through Jesus' sacrifice once and for all. And that phrase, have been sanctified, translates a perfect participle. Greek uses the perfect tense to describe something that's already been completed but continues to have lasting results. In other words, this has been accomplished and it still is true to this day. But it's not an ongoing process. It's not as though God is still working on this sanctification blessing. He's done it once and forever. And we are still the recipients of that blessing. Therefore, there is no longer any need for animal sacrifices. The priestly system of atonement in the Old Testament has been fulfilled entirely by the work of Christ. But who is sanctified in this way? Who is definitively sanctified? It's not all people in the world. It's not every Jewish person. Very clearly in the context, it is those who believe, those who truly belong to God, those who are cleansed from sin in order to serve Him through faith. For instance, in verse 19, He refers to them as brethren. He refers to them in verse 21 as those who have Christ as their high priest, those whose hearts have been cleansed, verse 22, those who have hope, verse 23. Later in the chapter, in verses 26 to 31, He describes the fact that there are some who are outwardly sanctified, but not truly inwardly sanctified. He talks about hypocrites in the church, in the visible covenant community. And He makes a distinction between those who have been definitively sanctified in verse 10 and those who will subsequently fall away later in chapter 10. In verse 10, He is not talking about a merely external or visible sanctification which might last for a time and then be abandoned. He is describing those whom He says in verse 39, do not draw back to perdition, but those who believe to the saving of the soul. But do you notice they've already been definitively sanctified? I cannot stress this point enough. They are not sanctified because they endure because they are sanctified. And it is realizing that, by the way, that over a decade ago, I became a Calvinist. Quite against my will, I assure you. If Lewis was the most unwilling convert in Great Britain, then I was the most unwilling Calvinist. But the reality is, this is what the Bible says, that God's people are not sanctified, justified, glorified because they endure. It says they will endure because they have been definitively sanctified, justified, and glorified. Those who truly belong to God in Christ are sanctified already. They are in a special relationship with Him, and that happened not by their decision, not by their work, not by their diligence, but once and for all by the sacrifice of Christ. Do you see that? It's not about the decision that you made to ask Jesus into your heart. It's not about the baptism you received. It's not about the choice that you make day by day as a disciple of the Lord. It's about what Jesus did, and what Jesus did accomplished this fact, and now that, as a consequence, is producing all of this response of love and faith and repentance and obedience in your life today. Skip down now to verse 14. Notice again, for by one offering He has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. Isn't that interesting? We saw a definitive sanctification in verse 10. Now we see a definitive perfection, or we might say glorification, in verse 14. Not only have God's people once and for all been set apart for God, by God, they have also been perfected forever. Think about that for just a minute. By Christ's sacrifice, not by your decision, not by your obedience, not by some final justification that you will obtain through your faithfulness and good works, but once and forever, you have already been perfected, even though you are still being sanctified at the present time. Are they perfected until the next time they sin? No. Are they perfected if they endure? No. Is this an offer or an opportunity? No. Do you see, this is the way Scripture talks about God's grace. Not as just the opportunity that He gives to you that you can choose to act upon. It describes grace as an accomplished fact, as an act of God, which is performed and completed and has permanent results. God's people are already glorified. And even though that sounds strange maybe to us because we think in terms and categories taught to us by systematic theology, listen to the language of Scripture. I'm not trying to critique or overturn our systematic theology. I just want to make sure that we biblically nuance it, to make sure that our understanding dogmatically is reflecting the diversity of language, terminology in Scripture itself. Romans chapter 8 and verse 30, "Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified." Not will one day we hope, if it turns out, glorify them. They are glorified just as surely as they are justified right now. We have been perfected forever by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And here you can see surely the parallel, the similarity between the way that the Hebrews writer is using this term perfected and the way that Paul would use the term justified. We are forgiven and we are accounted as righteous by God. We are accepted by God now and forever. Grace is not God punching the reset button and allowing you to start over. Try harder next time. Nope. Do it again. Nope. Do it again. God is wearing that button out in my life and in yours, right? That's not the way it works. There is not a reset button. There is a once and for all declaration that your sins are forgiven, past, present, and future. You are accepted by God, fully righteous, solely for the righteousness of Christ. Your good works are not contributing to that. Your good works are an important fruit of that, but they are not contributing to that assessment. The assessment is made by God based upon the work of Jesus. And so the Bible is very clear about this. By the sacrifice of Christ, God's people are perfected forever. Now, there are three points that we need to make real quickly, lest we misunderstand this verse. First, the ones who have been perfected by Christ still have to endure. Again, the latter part of chapter 10 talks about the reality that there are hypocrites who will not endure, that there will be pretenders in the visible church. They may be outwardly identified with Christ, but they do not truly belong to Him. They have not been truly perfected. But you must see that the perfection precedes perseverance. It does not follow it. Perfection precedes perseverance and enables and assures perseverance in those who are truly sanctified and perfected in this way. Secondly, those who have already been perfected are still being sanctified right now. Did you notice the shift of the tense? You can see this in English. Most of your English Bibles will show this. Verse 10 described those who have been sanctified. It's an accomplished fact. But verse 14, those who are being sanctified. It's an ongoing process. It's a present experience. And there's not a contradiction here. There's just nuance, right? Nuance. The way that the Scripture is speaking about this is recognizing that there is a sense in which sanctification is definitive, once and for all, fully complete, and there's another sense in which our sanctification is still ongoing. I've been made God's child, and now I'm being made more and more to look like God's child. I am God's child by grace. I am becoming more and more like God's Son by grace. In verse 10, sanctification is definitive. In verse 14, it's a process that's still incomplete, but one day will be complete because we have been forever perfected. And then third, just as definitive sanctification leads to progressive sanctification, so definitive glorification leads to future and final glory. I don't want you to despair when I say that God's people have been once and for all perfected by the sacrifice of Christ. I don't want you to despair to look around and say, this is as good as it gets. This is what perfection, like I look at myself in the mirror, you know, both physically and morally, and I say, this is as good as it gets, really? Glorification is not very glorious, Lord. No, it's glorious, but it's going to get gloriouser. God is not done. The definitive sanctification gives rise to this progressive sanctification that ultimately is accomplished in making us fully holy in terms of our moral behavior and attitudes and desires. In the same way, this definitive glorification assures that one day that glory will be fully revealed in the people of God. We have already been glorified with Christ in the heavenly places. We already partake of the divine nature, and one day, we will see those realities in a way and on a scale that we cannot even adequately imagine. Glory will be consummated when we are in the presence of Christ. And then verse 18. Now where there is remission of these, there is no longer an offering for sin. One of the things that the Hebrews writer is having to do is reason with and appeal to Jewish believers who are inclined to go back to the Old Testament economy to say we can believe that Jesus is the Messiah, but we can retain all of the trappings of our Hebrew heritage with regard to religion and atonement. By the way, the book of Hebrews is a devastating argument against much of the modern messianic movement, as is Paul's letter to the Galatians. We have to think very carefully about this. You cannot take Jesus and the Mosaic economy in both hands and hold them together. The Hebrews writer says, Christ has come, that's changed everything. It's changed the priesthood. It's changed the temple. It's changed the sacrificial system. All of that was good and right and necessary, but it was pointing us to Christ. And it is no longer of the same value. It can no longer serve the same role now that we have Christ. He says there is definitive remission by Christ's offering. And you build a third temple and you reinstitute a Levitical priesthood and you resume animal sacrifices. What are you doing? Well, what you're actually doing is abandoning the gospel. And yet it is a feature of a lot of theology today. You have to be very careful with those ideas. Notice the argument, verse 18. Where there is remission of these sins, there is no longer an offering for sin. The Lord's Supper is not a re-sacrificing of Christ. Our understanding of the Eucharist, the thanksgiving that the sacrament of the Lord's Supper is not to be that Jesus is being perpetually re-presented on the altar as if we continually have to bring that sacrifice. There's once and for all time a sacrifice been made, it's accomplished, it's been accepted. And there is something very special and indeed mystical going on when the church celebrates the Lord's Supper. We don't want to empty it of that, but we want to make sure that that is a biblically informed mystery. Jesus' sacrifice is complete, and forgiveness is therefore accomplished. We are forgiven, not just of the sins that we previously committed. We do not just have the opportunity to have our sins forgiven in the future. We have full forgiveness of all of our sins, past, present, and future, which, by the way, is why some scandalously and slanderously misrepresented the gospel that Paul preached in Romans chapter 3 and Romans chapter 6 as if it were antinomian, as if Paul is saying, let us do evil that good may come. The more I sin, the more God's grace is magnified. So let's party and disobey God and live like heathens because we know that God has forgiven us in Christ. Paul says, God forbid, that's not what I'm saying. That's not what the gospel teaches at all. But here is the reason some people could twist the gospel in that way. It's because when Jesus died, He didn't just die for the sins that I'd already committed. Jesus died 2,000 years before I was born. I hadn't committed any sins. And He doesn't die just to establish this blood bank so that every time I sin, I can go back to the blood bank and I can get a little more of Jesus' blood to wash away that sin also. Now I'm forgiven. Oh, now I stumble into sin and now I'm unforgiven. Now I'm innocent. Now I'm guilty. No, that's not the way that it works. Once and for all time, forgiveness has been given to the people of God. Now here again, we must make a distinction lest we imagine that none of us in this room have ever been guilty of any sin because all of our sins were forgiven 2,000 years ago. There's a sense in which you could understand that statement, but in fact that statement would not be true. There is a difference between forgiveness being purchased and forgiveness being applied. All those for whom it is purchased will receive that application, but there is nonetheless a distinction. Saul was not a forgiven man when he left for Damascus to arrest any Christians that he found there. He was forgiven by the time he arrived there. What changed? He met someone on the road and realized that he was persecuting the Messiah. He realized who Jesus was and he put his trust in Him. Jesus in the Lord's Prayer teaches us to pray for the forgiveness of our sins every day. We should do so and we do. But why would we if we have definitive remission? It is because a sanctified, perfected, and forgiven person will continue to acknowledge the sin in his life and his need for God's forgiveness. A sanctified and glorified person will realize the grace in which he stands and which he must not take for granted. Jesus does not have to die again. We do not need any further offering, any sacrifice, any act of penance. We are forgiven once and forever by grace, and we acknowledge that day by day as we say, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Jesus did not die to establish a general fund of forgiveness to which anyone and everyone may apply, but which otherwise is effective for no one. If Jesus' sacrifice only makes forgiveness possible, then we cannot say what the Hebrews writer says in these passages. We cannot say that God's people have been sanctified. We cannot say that they are already perfected forever. And we cannot say that they have full and final forgiveness. Because if grace is only an opportunity, if it is a potential blessing, if it is an invitation, then it is at least possible that no one would be redeemed by it because no one has been. It's only created that opportunity. But that's not grace. Grace is a divine operation. It is not potential, it is powerful and effectual. It accomplishes what God pleases for all those to whom He means to give it. And by way of conclusion, the Bible's very clear that Jesus doesn't die for sin in general. The Bible says He dies for our sins. He died for our sins according to the Scriptures. That's what Paul affirms in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He bore our sins in His own body on the tree. That's what Peter affirms in 1 Peter chapter 2. God's grace is specific and special. It will not fail because He cannot fail. He is not trying to save uncooperative sinners. He has saved His people by grace, and it is grace that makes sinners cooperative. Amen. Let's bow together. Gracious God and Father, we pray that You would enlarge our vision, our understanding of the power, beauty, and efficacy of Your grace. O Lord, that we would never take for granted the once and for all sanctification and glorification and remission of sins that is ours by virtue of the work and righteousness of Your Son. Bless us and help us to live with joy and gratitude each day in the present age for these great gifts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.